किस चीज़ का वीडियो? हाँ ठीक है, वो चला दीजिए। कितना देर का है? बाद नहीं कीजिएगा, टाइम नहीं है। तो आप मीटिंग नॉट येट स्टार्टेड, दूसरा वाला मीटिंग आप स्टार्ट किए हैं? तो उन लोग को वो सेकंड वाला लिंक है, कौन सा लिंक है? ये पैनल डिस्कशन वाला अलग है, लेकिन उन लोगों को नहीं आ रहा है, मतलब मीटिंग नॉट येट स्टार्टेड। अभी इट्स ऑलरेडी लाइव। सो वेलकम मिस्टर माथुर एंड मिस्टर, वेलकम संजीव जी।
या थैंक यू सो मच, यू जस्ट लॉगिंग इन।
या sorry for the delay, sorry, thanks for bearing with us.
That's all, we are waiting for Mr. Vivek Agarwal to join. I'm checking out, Jinesh is there. Oh, Jinesh is there, yeah he's there.
Welcome Jinesh.
I'm waiting for Mr. Vivek Agarwal to join. Just let's wait for a minute because all of us are having issues in joining.
So we can wait a couple of minutes.
Yeah, please.
So, dear participants, we have today with us some of the most eminent personalities in the agri-tech and agri-entrepreneurship domain with us, who have assembled here for a panel discussion on the topic of entrepreneurship opportunities in the agri-tech and agri-business sector. So we welcome all our esteemed panelists. The panel is going to be moderated by Shri Sanjeev Rangras, who is the Group Head of R&D and Sustainability Project and Chief Divisional Executive of Agribusiness Division, ITC. He is also an IIT Kanpur alumnus. With him, we have Shri Vivek Agarwal, Joint Secretary, Ministry of Agriculture, Government of India, and CEO of the PM Kisan. We have Shri Jinesh Shah, co-founder and managing partner for Omnivore, which is one of the most prominent agri-specific, agri-focused investor in India. We have Shri Hemendra Mathur, who is a venture partner at Bharat Innovation Fund and chairman of Task Force on Agri-Startups of FICCI. Along with them, we have Shri Rishabh of BizStreet and founder of Sujalam Sufalam Foundation. And he's a renowned agri-entrepreneur, very active in the agri-sector. We welcome all our esteemed panelists, and I request Shri Sanjeev Rangras to initiate the discussion. Welcome, Sanjeev ji.
Thank you so much to you. Thank you so much to the professors and the director of IIT Kharagpur. So without much ado, I know we are delayed. All our audience is delayed. Our panelists are delayed. So I'm going to start immediately. So before I start, I thought I will lay a context. We plan to restrict ourselves to 1 hour. So I'm not going to have an overrun on this. So we'll restrict it to 1 hour, and we'll make sure that I speak less and make sure that I get the best out of my panelists who are there. But I will make sure that all of them also. So I hope the thing is visible. Mr. Mathur, you can confirm to me if the presentation is visible.
Yes, it is. Sanjeev, go ahead.
Yeah, thank you so much. So just a few slides, because I know the people before us who did the inauguration did speak about the Indian agriculture. A lot has been spoken about in the last couple of years, and I'm sure the next decade is will belong to the Indian agriculture. So, see, I believe, and I've worked on it for 10, 11 years. I'm from IIT Kanpur, spent about 11, 12 years in agriculture. So there is, according to me, I've worked in several sectors. I worked in engineering production, I believe. This is absolutely most critical for our country's development. However, there are too many challenges in this. And if at all there is any sector which needs to improve, it is this sector for making India achieve its dream of $5 trillion economy. There are uncertainties, folks. All of you talk about variabilities. I don't think you would ever encounter any profession with unlike farming, which has so many uncertainties. There is issues of soil, there is issue of prices, there is issue of water, there's issue of all inputs, there is pests, lack of infrastructure, climate, there is, you name it, it is there, I think. And hence these challenges are nothing but an opportunity for us. So India has about 6.5 lakh villages, 120 million farmers, and about 80% small, 1 hectare to 2 hectare, 140 million farm laborers, 159 million hectares of arable land. That's large. This large, one of the largest in the world. The only country which has more arable land than us is USA. Yes, it is not China. China is only 100 million hectares. Look at the number of climatic zones we have. Look at the number of crops, right? 50% of my population gets employed here, but contributes to only 18% of my GDP. India, 159 million hectares. Friends, focus on this. 35 billion exports. Netherlands, 1 million hectare, 111 billion exports. Can you imagine? The small, tiny country, which is below the sea level, is able to generate $111 billion exports. So that is a country which we need to emulate. And look at this entire value chain from farming to market to processing to warehousing to consumers. It is all dependent on manual operations. And there's a huge scope for disruption. There's a huge scope for all your entrepreneurs and your technology, whatever we learn in IITs, to come and disrupt this. This is a challenge. So, you know, we all hear about Navier-Stokes equation. All you IIT people would know about it. You know, all those differential equations which you use to solve all that things about in fluid mechanics for incompressible liquids. This is a very simple equation, and yet it confuses most of us, right? Simple equation, two multiplication, one subtraction, leaving you to the net returns. This is complicated, my friends, and we've still not been able to master it. We need the young entrepreneurs to come and help us get the equation right. Not only get productivity high, get quality high, make sure the price is high for the farmer and yet price is affordable, and how to reduce the cost of cultivation. So these are huge issues for all of us. So challenges you will see, I just listed down. You name it, it is there in this field. It is there everywhere. So these challenges, according to me, are nothing but opportunities for an entrepreneur. And that is what people like Jinesh, Rishabh, Hemendra, Vivek are looking at. Can we convert these challenges into opportunities? Lot of needles are there, a lot of needle heads are there. We're trying to put the thread through this needle heads. We are waiting when it will pass through all the 99 needle heads. That's when we'll say it is Eureka. Let me assure you, not many of you in this room or people listening will choose agri as a career for your child. How many of us? My children are not there. I'm sure everyone in this room wouldn't have sent their children for agri. No one, right? How many of you would invest in an agri thing? You'll invest in, you know, Tesla, you'll invest in Bitcoins, you'll invest in all that. How many of you would invest in agriculture? Very few. But we have people like Jinesh, Hemendra, Rishabh, who are willing to put their, stick their neck out. And these are the people who are going to promote this entire ecosystem for us. So thanks for these panelists. Thanks to Vivek, who's also doing a terrific job with the Agri Entrepreneurship and the Agri Infrastructure Fund. So challenges, water folks, very quickly I'm going to run through. 89% of the country's entire groundwater is used by agriculture. 50% of the land still remains unused for half the productive months. I know I'm in Guntur right now, very close to East and West Godavari. We can get 2 to 3 crops of paddy because water is available. Water is oxygen for this. Labor. Oh, the country has huge labor, but there's no labor available for us. Right? So farmers are skipping operations. That's another, you know, mystery. What happens to all the labor? What happens to our 1.3 billion people? High wastage. 93,000 crores wasted in food wastage in across the chain. Pesticides. We have huge issues. People are use rampant amount of pesticides, and we are unable to export to countries because it just doesn't pass the requirements for other countries. So we have huge issues on that front. How do we address these challenges in the Indian context? Right? Can we draw some inspiration from some other countries? So the idea is draw inspiration from within the country. There are enough examples, but I thought I will still go back to Netherlands. It never ceases to surprise me that how can this small country of 1 million hectare, you know, generate 111 billion hectares of food exports. God, I think we need to learn a lot from these people. So you see this entire value chain from left to right, starting from sowing to the delivery. I think there are huge opportunities. I've put down all these things there because these are all opportunity areas for us, right? Which one of these should we prioritize to favorably impact farmer income? Folks, we cannot make a good business unless the farmer makes money. Farmer profitability is essential. then how do we scale these to have a pan-India impact? These are things which are burning issues for us, whether we are in the or implementation of this concept. Over to you, Rishabh.
Thanks, Sanjeev. Thanks for this. See, Indian agriculture ecosystem today, as we all know that, you know, 86% farmers own less than 2 or 3 hectares of land. So the FPO revolution is going to be a game changer. Today, we cultivate 160 million hectares of land with 38 different agroclimatic zones and 500 million people directly or indirectly associated with this sector. So 10,000 FPO is not, I would say, a very ambitious. We can have more, but how we should have it is the question. So in community commerce, the FPO need to be smaller. We don't need a large acreage farms. We need smaller, sustainable models of community-driven farming, which is we call community commerce. Now, in community, we have 7 pillars. Community is FPO, which is a recognized body under the state law or the central law. Like under Company Act, we can produce farmer-producer companies. Then the second pillar is connections. We need to link them with backward and forward linking. All the IIT, IIM people, professional people, if they can join, they need some structure. So the FPO is the perfect structure for them to join as an advisor or be part of the FPO, or even without owning the land, they can become agripreneurs. The third thing is communication. We have to do storytelling. As we all know that what Netherlands is doing best, because they are also best in terms of telling the story of what they are doing. So we need to be vocal about it, about our local things. Then collaboration with technology, which is given, because all the agri-tech startup, 400, 500 startup we have, this is just a beginning. It is just like 2008, we used to see the e-commerce. So today, agri-tech is just like that, and it will evolve much bigger. Content is very important, because packaging, sorting, farm to kitchen journey, like Amul says that they, for them, C2C is cow to consumer, B2C is buffalo to consumer. Similarly, we should have the content which is palatable to the consumer. So the journey between farmer to consumer need to be reduced. Creativity, again, solving the local problem in local manner. And the seventh pillar, the last pillar is commerce. The pricing delta and the profit in the hands of grower. What my consumer is paying and what my farmer is getting. I think this can be built with the technology when the distributed ledger system or blockchain, something will come, some aggregation will happen, and ultimately both consumer and farmer will get benefited and everybody in between will add their value and get what they should be getting. So this is the overall concept of community commerce. Now, how this can be implemented? 26 million hectares is wasteland, not being cultivated so far. And as our Honorable Prime Minister said that they want to cultivate, the India want to cultivate by 2030, all this land. So all the policy push, as well as the larger farm, we can also have a larger farm. We can also employ our youth into that, provided we have a public-private partnership model. And cooperative is the best model without touching the sensitive issue of ownership of land. Let the ownership remain with the government. Let the ownership remain with the small farmer. Without touching the ownership, as we all know how Uber has transformed the transport system, we can have similar sort of model which are more local, more sustainable. Over to you.
Thanks, Rishabh. So what I captured from you are some good C's. I captured communication, I captured collaboration, I captured creativity, commerce. And I heard, for the first time, I've heard B2C as buffalo to consumer. I'm walking out with some good learnings. So Jinesh, over to you to tell us how you leverage this B2C, buffalo to consumer, and other things. So a very straightforward question to you. You are the big funder, the big punter in the agri-tech area. So you've been closely involved with a lot of startups. And let me tell you, lots of people are listening to you today. Can you please share the major challenges that startups in the Indian agriculture, what do they face, and what do you think should be done to bridge these gaps? Because lots of people approach me, and I don't think I'm the right advisor. I think people like you should advise, because you've been advising hundreds of them. So over to you, Jinesh.
Sure. Thanks, Sanjeev, for the question. Thanks, IIT, for help for giving me this channel to speak about it. I mean, we've been looking at the startup funding for now nearly a decade, right? And one of the major challenge which typical entrepreneur in the agri sector faces is the amount of interactions what he has with the farmers, right? If I run a consumer tech startup or a tech startup, I probably have a few dozens of interactions with my customers every month or at least in a year, right? But in the agriculture business, unless you are in the business of dairy or fishery, your interactions or the number of attempts what you can get to talk with your customers is like two or three. India has two or three crop cycles depending on the state and the district where you are. And if you are missing out one of those interaction points, whether because of weather or because of ability of the startup not ready with the product for testing out, or the farmer is not able to understand, then you lose out this 3 or 4 months around it. And that becomes a challenge for entrepreneurs, because when they speak to any investor who is a typical VC investor or an angel investor, they would like to say, okay, how fast can you grow about it? Can you make 3 or 4 product versions in a span of 12 months, or can you see me interactions? But in agriculture, it doesn't happen, right? You have Mother Nature takes its own sweet time to produce, and entrepreneurs sometimes are not able to time that. I mean, I'm not saying that everyone will be able to do it, right? And that remains a big challenge for the entrepreneurs, because there is difference between the capital speed, what investors expect, and what the entrepreneurs expect. Second, I think we see a lot of people, tech entrepreneurs, smart engineers, trying to make an app and sitting in their home offices or in offices in Delhi, Bombay, Bangalore, or the large cities, and telling what a farmer should be doing. I mean, they probably have not moved their butts in the villages or in the farmland, but they advise the farmers that this is what their problem is and they should be doing that. It's just like, just because we've been in the top talented school in the country, doesn't mean we know everything about agriculture, and that becomes a big challenge. Third, I think there's another issue is that a lot of entrepreneurs who come from IIT or the Ivy school, they are very fresh from the colleges, right? They think what they learn from the colleges or something is the most apt thing, and they should be able to advise farmers. They have not spent time and energy in working with companies like ITCs or Godrejis of the world, really understanding what it takes to sell a piece or buy a produce from the farmer and sell it to consumer, or sell, buy the inputs and give it to farmers. I mean, this is a gap they have it, right? And a combination of things is this three is the biggest challenge what the entrepreneurs are facing it.
Thanks, Jinesh. That is good, because when I joined IDC in 1982, I remember all the people in the marketing. We always say consumer is God. So we had to spend 21 out of 30 days in the field. So you're right. I've been in Guntur for the last decade, and I've realized that there are several people who come from Bombay, Delhi, and they haven't, I think, seen a field in ages. So I think that is the key learning for entrepreneurs. You have to dirty your shoes. You have to dirty your collar, you have to walk, and you have to spend time. Unless you do that, you're not going to be a successful entrepreneur. So moving back to Mr. Hemendra Mathur. Mr. Mathur, you speak about, in several forums, we've heard you talk about enabling ecosystem as the key for accelerated growth of agri-tech startups, right? What do you think, is required to create this perfect ecosystem? There is Jinesh there, there's Mr. Agarwal there, everyone is trying. What is your mantra for this, holy grail, as I say, which will create this perfect ecosystem for agri-tech startup?
Thanks, Sanjeev. It's a great question. And I would say there are probably 5 or 6 pillars of this ecosystem. First and foremost, incubators who can handhold startups, who can mentor them, who can do seed funding. Fortunately, this has really picked up, places like AIDEA Naam, Will Grow, CIICO, there are probably more than a dozen incubators, and of course the one which is opening at IIT Kharagpur, I think have done a tremendous job in building the startup ecosystem. So kudos to them. Second is investors. Again, we have Jinesh on the call, and there are few others like Ankur and Avishkar who took the early stage bets in this sector. Of course, it was initially more of an impact investing play, but fortunately, that investor base is broad-basing. There are investors coming from outside India. There are investors who never invested in agri-tech are now investing in agri-tech. So I would say that is also probably, getting there. Third, I would say is FPOs and village level ecosystem, and Vivek sir also mentioned about it. It's so critical to empower the local sort of people to take this innovation from Bangalore to Barabaki. You know, I think that kind of ecosystem is kind of missing. We need to train rural youth. We need to find the right NGOs or FPOs who can understand these innovations and kind of educate the farmers about it. The fourth one I would say is corporates, which include large corporates as well as SMEs. I would say that again, there's a lot to be done. Of course, we are for a change seeing a lot of corporate interest. Of course, ITC is one of them, but likes of Nestle, Marico, DCM, Shriram, Bayer. There are again many corporates who are engaging with startups. And I think one thing which I find a little bit, where the things are disconnected is MSMEs and startups. Because a lot of food processing, a lot of agribusiness are still in MSME sector. But they don't talk to startup, neither startup talk to them. I think that is one missing link which I see. The fifth one is, I would say, talent. And fortunately, we had a very smart army of agri-tech entrepreneurs. Most of the entrepreneurs come with a very strong tech background. But I think the talent which is needed to scale the businesses, I think is still a lot to be done. And I think that has a clear sort of repercussions on our education system also. For example, I always say that there's a lot of application of data sciences in agriculture, you know. But I myself as an agriculture engineer. And if you look at any agriculture university, there are hardly any courses on data sciences, machine learning, artificial intelligence. So how do we, create a talent pool by looking at our education system, by looking at a curriculum to make it more innovation friendly? I think that is something which we need to see. Last but not the least, the digital ecosystem. And again, the government of India is working very hard on it. And of course, Vivek sir has done a great job in creating an agri stack of sort, where we can digitize farmland, where we can connect farmer ID to farm ID, which can essentially enable the challenge, which can solve the challenge of the first mile and last mile access to farmers. I think that is where we need a very, very strong digital highway, and all the innovation which is being developed and is going to be developed, can really be accelerated if we have a digital access to farmers. And so is the lot of schemes which government has. They can be enrouted through it, and our lending infrastructure or insurance infrastructure can become far better. So I would say these are like maybe five or six pillars of the ecosystem evolving, changing for good, but a lot to be done.
Okay, so my take is, that's the question I said, I asked people, how many people would send their children for agricultural education or would like them to become a farmer? So that is a big question. And I think I agree with you on the issue of talent, because these days when I go to recruit in the IITs, everyone seems to be doing a course in data analytics or machine learning, artificial intelligence. So if the government is so clear and we believe that the country's future depends on agriculture, why isn't there one compulsory course or two on agriculture in India? These are essential components. So the question you may ask me is, what is ITC doing about it? We are starting one program. I've done it in IIT Gandhinagar, where we are getting some internship people to come and experience rural India. I don't think students even understand what rural India is all about. So I know that several of you have talked about FPO. So Mr. Agarwal, let me get back to you on that. So everyone seems to be talking about FPOs. That's the latest buzzword, right? So you've given a big thrust to this entire thing. I think Rishabh spoke about it. Mr. Hemendra spoke about it. So somehow this is an important element. I also believe, several people believe. But how do you think this entire concept of FPO, which is supposed to build an Atmanirbhar, a self-reliant ecosystem, can be leveraged to create a fertile environment for entrepreneurs and innovation in the agri value chain? Over to you, sir.
In fact, there is strength in cooperation, and there is strength in organization. So FPOs symbolizes that. an individual farmer cannot look at a value chain or at an investment. I'm an individual farmer, my only choice is that I grow a certain produce and I go to the nearest agriculture market and sell it. But if I have to look at storage, if I have to look at primary processing, value addition, having a system where cold chain is available, or where I look at the issue of bargaining power with the farmer, all that is not possible unless and until farmers come together. And FPO is that. The basic strength of FPO is that it is an organization of the farmers and by the farmers. So normally, there's an entrepreneur who comes and sets up a business and skips off or takes away the maximum profit out of that business. In an FPO, the concept is that it is an organization of farmers, and this organization, which has its office bearers appointed or elected by the farmers themselves, they work for the farmers' interest. And if they have a capital and they have the organizational strength of a number of farmland and number of farmers, then they can have access to technology, they can have access to capital, they can look at providing a bargaining power to the members, they can provide marketing access, they can get inputs which are of better quality, they can provide market intelligence to its members so that they grow what can be sold, and they can of course look at markets much beyond the physical boundaries of the close by agriculture produce market committee markets or nearby area. So all those things can come up if there are well-structured FPOs in a particular area. And then these FPOs can also become engines for the private enterprise to come and collaborate. Because once you have an organized institution which has a large number of members access, then somebody who wants to do contract farming, somebody who wants to set up a value chain infrastructure linked to a large number of farmers, somebody wants to introduce a new crop, a new input, all that can also be done through an organized system that is at the grassroots level. But there are challenges. It's easier said than done. I mean, having an organized setup where farmers have an equal vote, where farmers have the say in organization, where there is a community leadership that has to be demonstrated by whoever runs those FPOs, all these things don't come very easily. And it's like a startup. So if an FPO is built, then there is always a possibility that some of them will be highly successful and some of them will lack the basic strength to stand. So the government's interface is important here, because the initial handholding, the initial capital that is required, the salaries to the paid employees that has to be paid in the first 2-3 years, if that comes from the government, that is what government has done now under the new FPO policy, where we are promoting 10,000 new FPOs all over the country, which aims at least setting up one FPO in each block. So if that process becomes successful, then even if out of these 10,000 startup FPOs, as we may call them, even if 50 or 60% become successful, then we can have a real revolution at the grassroots level. And that will be the primary agents of engagement for young entrepreneurs to take the movement forward and to have opportunities in value addition and opportunities in making good business ventures. Ultimately, business is for making profit, and financial sustainability is extremely important. The biggest challenge for a new business is that farmers don't have the capacity to pay or the willingness to pay for the services they are receiving. But if there's an organized setup like a FPO, then anybody who's bringing in new technology or a new innovation, they can look at getting remunerative returns by providing that technology to that FPO. And then further, that FPO engages with the members and creates a business model both for itself as well as for the entrepreneur that is engaging with them.
Thank you, Mr. Agarwal. I think from the government perspective, if you ask me, creating this FPOs, creating the drive for 10,000 and the sort of funding which you have promised to support it is actually, according to my perspective, a big boon. Because if you walk in as a sole entrepreneur and try to link up all parts of the value chain, it seems a daunting task. So FPO is that particular body. And to all the young budding entrepreneurs who are listening to this, please leverage this body. To me, this is the best organized creation which has been done by the government and also funded by the government. So it enables you to stitch together the entire value chain. I completely endorse it. And I have now one a question from the panel, which I'm going to address to Rishabh. So Rishabh, you know, Mr. Mathur talked about the weighted cost of capital. And if you ask me, from my perspective also, when I see the value chain, I see huge issues in credit. The fact remains that the middleman today controls everything, because agar kisan ke ghar mein zarurat hai, toh money is required. He needs money for wedding, he needs money for some illness, he needs money for something or the other, right? Which he's not able to do it. So tell me, capital credit and other credit is one of the major hurdles in micro entrepreneurship in the rural India. So the question being asked by one of the people in the audience is, how do you think this issue can be reduced, if not mitigated?
Yeah, so Sanjeev, as Vivek sir said, that you know, FPO is an organized structure. The moment we get into organized structure, the risk matrix of any lender goes down. And as Hemendraji told, that you know, 20% is the average cost of capital for the input for the farmer, both agri input as well as non-agri input. That cannot make the agriculture business profitable or viable for the farmer. So basically, it's directly connected with risk and the governance. The more governance will improve with the FPO setup. If 500 farmers collectively will come together in a FPO, they will have their GST number, they will have their board, they will have their governance, and they can use technology. And they will ultimately link their agriculture, whatever they will grow, it will be linked to the retail. So they will not grow anything haphazard. So their growth will be, you know, structured, and their cost of capital will go down. As in the previous session, the NABARD chairman, Dr. Chintala, told that, you know, there are a lot of subvention schemes available. So those schemes are available for the FPOs, for the group of farmers, and individual farmer may or may not be able to take those benefit of those schemes, but collectively, yes, they can reduce their cost of capital. Now, arbitrage is killing the profitability at the input level. At the post-harvest level, if the farm gate processing is not happening, then the farmer is not getting the advantage of fair sale, and he is bound to do the fire sale. So if that is, those two aspects are taken care, then in the age of artificial intelligence, I am talking about community intelligence, CI. So again, I'm giving you another terminology, that let us not look at only AI, let us look at the community intelligence. And where the entrepreneur coming from IITs, they can look at this opportunity, get into a setup, and government is opening up for FPOs. And later on, of course, a lot of policy push is still required, wherein FPO can convert tomorrow, they can bring their own IPOs, and they can involve public also. The moment you get organized, everybody will be interested to invest. So that is my take. And now there is a lot of SDG compliant funding, a lot of green funding can come, but it will come only when the setup is large enough to sustain, and they are creating a lot of social impact as well as climate resilient agriculture. A lot of funds are coming up. Probably Hemendraji and Jinesh Bhai, they know much about it. But I would say that access to capital will not be a problem. The organization and the governance need to be strengthened. The education need to be there, and it should be a free education, because the farmer know how to farm the land. They know how to till, how to do tilling, but they don't know how to make it agri business or agri venture. There the startup can play a big role. Thank you.
Thank you, Rishabh. Thanks for giving those things. So I now waiting for you to start your own fund and make all these things happen. And I will also personally invest along with you. Not only, and push even Jinesh and Hemendra also to invest in your fund and use all the community intelligence that you've been talking of. So Jinesh, you and your omnivore obviously attracts a lot of attention. Yeah. So someone said na ki wo, because Netherlands talks about it, that's why they know, we do not know India. So omnivore obviously is talking a lot. So you are the face of the investment in agri. So you recently printed a report on future of Indian agriculture and food 2030. So 2030 is the word in everyone's document. But so there are a few trends you've spoken of, right? So what are those trends which will define Indian agriculture? I know Mr. Mathur talked about things which are unexplored, like spices, hemp, and fisheries. So what are those trends which you see in 2030? How does it depend on the changing consumer needs? Will it be still very, very India-focused, or will it be very export-focused? And how do these trends and the emerging technologies enmesh and match? Over to you, Jinesh.
Hey, thanks, Sanjeev. Look, I mean, the report has generated reasonable traction and a lot of talking points within the industry, right? Because we tried to create beyond a normal report, right? The intention was clear to say that agriculture is not an unglamorous sector. There is not a sector where you don't make money. There is a chance to make a lot of money, right? And you have a chance to use a lot of technology in the sector. I mean, people talk about IoT and other solutions. I mean, in next 5-6 years, I think agriculture will have more IoT devices than any other sector in this country, right? So that's going to happen for sure. I mean, what we really like about the 2030 report is that we call it the farming of one, right? Like every individual human being wants to have its own privacy and its own customization, what they are doing, what they wanted. We believe in the same way, mapping out what the consumer needs in terms of his nutrition value, what he wants, mapping out with what the farmer is able to do it, and can we use technology to ensure that each and every plant is treated as a separate unit and not just as a farm per acre kind of a thing, right? So if Sanjeev as a person wants to have a particular nutrition in a particular kind of a food based on his doctor's advice, can the farmer look at that feedback and say, can I produce for Sanjeev this kind of a crop? I'll use the particular fortification if required and give it to Sanjeev with complete traceability and transparency around it. And the day I am able to achieve that, Sanjeev as a customer will be able to pay a premium, farmer will be able to make more money, and all the technology players will be able to reap the benefit of the same, right? I mean, that is what we think in the next 10 years, we're going to see that. That it's going to mean that there's going to be more increased interaction with the consumer and the farmer. It's not going to be handling this in a standalone basis. I mean, we think exports India, the exports in India between the Netherlands and India is like a wrong comparison, because Indian policies, Indian push was being done, or the acts were being done when the country was scarce in food production, right? Today, for the first time, I think there is a situation that we have a surplus. We realize that we don't need to produce for feeding ourselves. We have enough to feed ourselves and we need to export around it. For once, the government has started talking on export surpluses and giving targets on that hopefully should work out well. I think the attempt of the government to make a farm loss was to the direction, but hopefully at some point there would be some consultation with the farmer and the government, which hopefully will resolve and move the pace forward. I think, Sanjeev, the biggest challenge what India faces, and I think this is something which we have highlighted in the report, is the climate change, right? India is going to have a significant impact on the climate change. And one thing we realize that when in the world there is a major change happening, whether it's climate or anything, the poorer or the smaller stakeholders get impacted the most. Unfortunately, India's 90% of farmers are smallholder farmers. It is something which we think could disrupt the entire growth of agriculture sector. I mean, we have issues of dropping soil quality, dropping water table, the issues of farmers not listening to what the market's wanting, they're producing, the government interventions of MSPs. I mean, these are not market dynamics, right? I mean, we could do all subsidies to the farmers. And I think for the once, the government of India started giving money directly to the hands of farmers rather than giving to a company saying, buy a tractor or buy a machine or buy some kind of fertilizers. If you're able to move to that direction, maybe that helps. But we need to get worried about the climate change, right? A 2-3 degrees temperature increase across the country would mean that the agroclimatic zones of the country are going for a toss. I mean, if the temperature in Punjab rises by 3 degrees or 4 degrees, I don't know how much wheat can I produce in that temperature. And that significantly is a challenge. But when there's a challenge, hopefully smart people from IITs and other smart engineers would figure the piece out, and that would throw out opportunities. And hopefully people like us would be more than willing to make an investment bet on the same. I think this is what we think is going to happen in agriculture next 10 years. Could be interesting, could also be a death for the Indian agriculture. I mean.
Thanks, Dinesh. So you talked about two things which I picked out, my takeaways. On one hand, you talked about tailoring a crop for an individual called Sanjeev, right? So which lends itself to traceability, means a specific requirement for him. And whilst I was feeling good about it, you suddenly talked about climate change and all, and suddenly reminded me about the grim reality. I think that is very right. And you also talked about, this is the first time perhaps we have surplus and we're talking about agri exports. So let me now break the cycle and go back to Mr. Agarwal and ask him, because I believe that this particular ministry where Mr. Agarwal is at the forefront of wanting to bring changes, pushing for changes. So my compliments, Mr. Agarwal, to you and all the members of your ministry who have really, you know, in the last couple of years been trying to bring about changes and mass changes, something which we in corporates can't even understand the scale. So this issue of climate change, which Dinesh has talked about, could you tell me, it is predicted that large parts of Indian arable land can go dry. You do not pay attention. So what is your ministry or others perhaps doing to make sure that it indeed does not happen? So Mr. Agarwal, I would request you to give us your views on this.
Climate change resilient or climate resilient agriculture is one of the focus areas while we are looking at the R&D effort that is being done by ICAR. And there has always been focus on crops which are low water use crops. As you know, in past few years, there has been a focus on pulses. There has been focus on rain-fed agriculture. We are looking at areas which were not cultivated earlier, which have been brought under cultivation. We have taken the cycle of crops from single cropping to double cropping. We have also looked at areas where there was a fallow land after the rice cultivation was done. So rice fallow areas were identified in the entire country. They were only taking one rice crop and then keep the land fallow, especially in the eastern part of the country. In those areas, we have introduced pulses and other crops because the soil moisture, there was no need for further irrigation. The soil moisture was sufficient to sustain another crop. So all those steps are being taken. The research effort to have better quality of seeds, more climate resilient seeds, that has also been going on. And there is also a program where we shift the farmer from high water consuming crops to low water consuming crops by bringing a package of practices and by bringing a package of incentives as well. Like if a farmer is growing paddy or sugarcane, then we are doing, in sugarcane, we are doing intercropping of pulses and oil seeds so that the dependence on sugarcane is reduced and slowly the farmer can be weaned off from high water consuming crops. There has been a process of treating soil. The soil is being treated by gypsum, soil is being treated with other natural elements so that the sustainable agriculture can be done. There is also an effort, we have issued soil health cards to all farmers in the country. The introduction of fertilizer, so that there is no introduction of fertilizer which is not required. So excessive use of fertilizer is being controlled by informing the farmer about the need of the soil. There is a huge increase in organic farming area in the country. We have set up a proper marketing system for organic farm produce. We're going for natural farming practices. Special FPOs have been constituted just to look at organic farming and to promote organic farming in various parts of the country. There are some states which are purely organic, like Sikkim is totally organic. And there are areas which were basically inhabited by tribals. They were naturally organic because the use of chemical fertilizer was low. Now we are branding those crops that are grown in these areas and focus is that they get better price for their crops, and they don't shift from the ancient practice of organic agriculture to the so-called modern agriculture. There is also a focus to sustain millets, the agriculture in millet production. So all the traditional millets like Kodu, Kutki, Sama, they have been identified, a seed chain is being built, and all the traditional millets, which are in some of those millets, India is the only producing country in the world. We are preserving those areas and helping those farmers to have better income so that they don't shift out of millets. We try to improve their productivity, and better cropping practices are being introduced. We also have a seed bank. We have a genetic seed bank at the national level, where the genetic diversity of Indian agriculture seed system is being maintained. So the seed genetics, the genomes of seeds which are traditional to Indian agriculture have been preserved, and they are being used to produce new varieties of seeds, which will be again climate resilient seeds. So there is a huge movement that is there for keeping Indian agriculture sustainable and competitive. So what Jinesh said may not be, there may not be any possibility of India losing out on climate change. We are well prepared, and on all aspects of climate resilient agriculture, the government is aware of it, and we are working, all wings of the government, including the research wing, is working relentlessly to tackle that issue, both from the farming practices point of view as well as from the research point of view.
Thank you so much, Mr. Agarwal. That's a big comfort. So, Jinesh, you can go and invest freely now. You don't have to, restrict yourself. So, I have been privy to whatever Mr. Agarwal and the large team is doing. And believe me, you know, you and I believe in the corporate sector. We work 18 hours. I've seen people work 48 hours, 72 hours nonstop. So, we have seen this happen in the COVID time also. I think all of us were safely locked up in our houses. But when I saw Mr. Agarwal, he was in the office. I saw all government officials going to offices. So I think I would salute all these people who are really championing this entire movement for us. And I've got a prompt from the people that we are ending the time. So I am going to thank every one of you. But before I conclude, I would like to, in conclusion, share a few slides, which would be some of the comments which you people have made, and leave you and all the people with some thought. So just give me a second, please. So, in conclusion, we've listened to four terrific panelists out here. So, Shri Vivek Agarwal talked about agri-infrastructure fund focus. He talked about post-harvest management infrastructure. He talked about venture debt fund for startups at early stage. He talked about smart agri-crop advisory and AI, ML, blockchain. He's talked about FPOs as engines for private companies to collaborate with. Need for initial handholding and capital requirements for success of FPOs. We need to do it. I think he talked about social entrepreneurship. I think we need to be very careful. We need to support. We need to support our farmers. And one FPO per block. I think the aim for 10K, but FPOs can grow to 20,000, 30,000. This is the immediate aim, to create a seeding environment. Then Shri Hemendra Mathur talked about opportunities in Indian agriculture, agri-fintech, specialized value chains. We talked about spices, hemp, and fisheries. Sir, fisheries is one of the highest export areas. I thought I will mention to you. You talked about climate resilient agriculture, which Mr. Vivek Agarwal said, don't worry, the government is doing it, not only at the water end, which is what I raised as an issue, but even at the seed end, which is the germination point for all the agriculture. And you talked about very eloquently about the six pillars to create, or seven pillars, I could only capture so many. We talked about incubators, investors, village level ecosystem with FPOs. We talked about corporates, SMEs partnership, talent, and agri-stack.
So thank you very much for your insights. Then we had Rishabh. Rishabh is a person with his own framework, community commerce framework, 7 pillars. He talked about community, connections, content, creativity, communications, collaborations, commerce. So I'm looking forward to come to Delhi and meet you and understand these in greater detail. And then you also talked about how FPO brings in organized structure and community intelligence as key area for emerging entrepreneurs. Jinesh, you heading Omnivore, you really touched a raw chord with me when you talked about less interaction with customers. In our case means less interaction with farmers. You can't sit in Delhi and talk about farmers. You have to be out there in the field. You need to see your shoes get mud on it. You can't be sitting in swanky white Nike shoes in the office. And there's a disconnect. I completely endorse it. I see so many of them, gap in understanding the farmer requirements. We need to be there. And we from our side will do whatever is possible to connect people. And I will urge all the IITs also to perhaps bring in some orientation towards that. On the second part, you talked about creating food for individuals, which I just talked about, and you talked about climate change. So thank you so much for this. But before I leave, I think whenever we think about climate resilience, we think about so many things. I thought I would bring out this slide quickly. I draw a lot of inspiration from Israel. Do not forget that we are nowhere close to where Israel is. Israel, look at this on the left, on the right. 25 centimeter average rainfall versus India's 154. 2% water cover with high groundwater salinity. 55 degrees Celsius to minus 18. We don't even face this. With high diurnal variations, 80% of soils classified as desert silt. Folks, we are in a very, very good spot. You don't worry about that. India, if you compare every day you think about Israel, you say I'm far better off. Toughest possible condition for agriculture. And yet, look at this, one of the highest yields in the world. So that's where, whilst I spoke a lot about Netherlands, there's another country which you can look at and draw inspiration from. The world's most developed irrigation methods, the world's most reused water rate, the most advanced ICT technologies. And that is what people from IIT Kharagpur and the others need to do, right? All of us need you to go ahead and do something better than what Israel does. And this is a gamut of technologies which they do. So AgTech provides answers to all our questions there. So folks, with these few thoughts, I will give a special thanks to all the panel members, to Dr. Ramesh Pokhriyal Nishank, who is the chief guest, Dr. G.R. Chintala, chairman of NABARD, Professor V.K. Tiwari, director of IIT Kharagpur, Professor, Assistant Professor Brigank, thanks for inviting all of us, and all other professors, members involved in this amazing initiative. And thank you, and Jai Hind. Thank you so much.
Thanks a lot for the amazing, amazing panel discussion. Now I request Professor H.N. Mishra, the professor in charge of the Agribusiness Incubation Center, to kindly share his note.
Okay. Thank you, Mrigank. And let me first congratulate and express our sincere thankfulness and regards to all the panel members. And especially the moderator, Mr. Sanjeevji. Sri Sanjeevji, he has very, very nicely conducted the event, and finally, more importantly, very nicely elaborated the things and concluded the things, whatever discussion was held during this 1 hour long. And I was just looking at the things which Mrigank was showing me, that how meticulously the whole panel discussion was planned by you. That is, even what are the points to be discussed, and this Vivek Agrawal ji, aapka jo input raha hai, Jignesh Shah, Shah ji, and hamare baki do Hemant माथुर जी, ऋषभ जी, मैं तो फिर दोबारा उसको रिपीट नहीं करूंगा, ऑलरेडी इट हैज़ बीन नाइसली समराइज, बट वी विल ओनली से आई ऑन बिहाफ ऑफ द इंडियन इंस्टीट्यूट ऑफ टेक्नोलॉजी खड़गपुर एंड एग्री बिजनेस इंक्यूबेशन सेंटर, वी ऑलवेज वी आर ग्रेटफुल टू यू. फॉर्मल वोट ऑफ थैंक्स विल बी गिवन बाई माई कलीग्स, बट एंड वन थिंग आई वुड डेफिनेटली, बिकॉज हियर वी आर, यू सी ऋषभ जी इज, आई थिंक संजीव इज फ्रॉम आई आई टी कानपुर, यू आर एलुमनाई ऑफ आई आई टी कानपुर, तो वी आर प्रोफेसर हियर, वी ठीक है, हम लोगों को सब्जेक्ट मालूम है, चीज़ें मालूम है, बहुत सी चीज़ें प्रैक्टिकल या गांव में. सो हियर वी हैव इन एग्रीकल्चरल एंड फूड इंजीनियरिंग डिपार्टमेंट एट ABIC, वी हैव टेकन दिस न्यू इनिशिएटिव, बिकॉज नाउ वी वॉन्ट व्हाट एवर वी हैव डेवलप्ड इन द लेबोरेटरी आर इन द पायलट प्लांट, वी वॉन्ट टू टेक इट टू द पीपुल, एंड इन दिस वी रियली वॉन्ट टू यूटिलाइज योर एक्सपर्टाइज, वी वॉन्ट योर गाइडेंस. मे बी समटाइम आई एम श्योर दैट वी विल गेट सम अदर अपॉर्चुनिटीज, एंड आफ्टर द कोरोना पैंडमिक सिचुएसन इज ओवर, डेफिनेटली वी विल वेलकम यू पीपुल होल टीम एट खड़गपुर. समटाइम वी विल डू दिस थिंग अगेन इन मे बी इन फिजिकल प्रेजेंस ऑफ यू ऑल, एंड ऑल्सो वी होप एंड द इनक्यूबेटिज एक्सेट्रा which we have planned, that during this event we plan that about 25-30 incubators we will select, and so I hope that all these incubators they will get, we ABIC as well as our incubators, they will all get your support and mentorship in converting them into a real agri business entrepreneurship and finally contributing towards the development of the country, development of the nation, and making India आत्मनिर्भर in real sense. क्योंकि अगर हमारे गाँव का विकास होगा, हमारे गाँव के किसानों का, गाँव के यूथ का विकास होगा, तो हमारे देश का विकास होगा और हम सब का विकास होगा. इन शब्दों के साथ में मैं एक बार पुनः आप सब लोगों का आभारी हूँ. नमस्कार.
Namaste ji. Thank you so much. Thank you. Good day and good night.
Thank you, sir, for the vote of thanks. And once again, I would like to thank all the panelists, Sanjeev ji, Rishabh, Hemendra ji, Jinesh, as well as Vivek ji, for coming over, spending time and giving us such a wonderful discussion. We are looking forward to your closer involvement with the IT Khadakpur community and especially the Agribusiness Incubation Center. I'm pretty sure your collaboration, your support, your guidance will be very helpful for the Institute in future. So with this, we come to the conclusion of today's event. We thank all the participants for coming over and attending the program, and we are looking forward to your participation in the hackathon that starts from tomorrow. We will be sharing all the information regarding the hackathon in a session that will be announced by email. So looking forward to all your participation. Thank you.
Thanks.
Thank you. Thank you, Sanjeev ji.
Thank you, ji. Thank you so much. Bye. Namaste, ji.